Thank you very much, Dr. De Leon, for the kind introduction. Okay, colleague. Okay, a pleasant morning to all of us. Okay, so please allow me to share my screen. Okay, so every time I start my class, okay, so look at my class, I always ask questions to my students. And before I start my presentation, okay, I would like to ask one question, okay, to our participants, especially that we have a lot of students who are, okay, attending this webinar. Okay, it works. Mm-hmm. Okay, the question is, what is an extreme environment? They asked by Dr. Martinez, okay, what is an extreme environment? Okay, so how do we go about in defining what an extreme environment is? Okay, I think he was able to give you, okay, a definition of what an extreme environment is, okay, and that is in terms of an environmental factor affecting growth of the organism, and this is usually expressed in a quantitative manner. An environment with high temperature, okay, low pH is considered as an extreme environment. Now, another way of defining what an extreme environment is in terms of species diversity. So an environment is said to be, okay, an extreme environment. Mentioned by Barnum and Evans, an environment that permits the development of a wide diversity of microorganisms or places moderately selective pressure on its inhabitants is not regarded as an extreme. Okay, so with that, we can think about the low temperature environments. Can we consider low temperature environments as extreme environments when in fact, okay, there is diversity, okay, very wide diversity observed in such an environment. So it is one thing that we can think about. Okay, so for today, okay, so after asking that question, okay, so we'll now move on to a special group of organisms with a lot of biotechnological applications, and that is the, okay, alkaliphiles. Of course, these are unusual resources, okay, coming from usual sites. Now, for my short presentation, okay, so we will try to answer the following questions. Okay, so one, what are alkaliphiles? Okay, two, now how do alkaliphiles survive in environments with high pH? Okay, next, what are the biotechnological applications of alkaliphiles? They are important, unusual resources. And of course, okay, to give you, okay, the result or to present the result of our studies on one naturally occurring alkaline spring, okay, what are the alkaliphilic organisms present in Maniluwag alkaline spring and their possible applications? Okay, so we start with definition. They are describing what an alkaliphilic microorganism is. Okay, now as defined by Hirokoshi, who is the lead, okay, on or really started the work on alkaliphiles, it is defined as microorganisms that grow optimally or very well at pH values above 9, often beyond 10 and 12, but cannot grow or grow only slowly at the near neutral pH, okay, values of 6.5. Now, as given by Wigel, okay, alkaliphiles can be further divided into two groups. We have the so-called facultative alkaliphile as well as the obligate alkaliphile. Now, the only difference between the two is that the facultative alkaliphile has a pH minimum which is less than 7.5. Okay, so it can grow, okay, at a pH which is less than 7.5, but it is not as lavish as that of neutrophilic organisms. Now, on the other hand, in the case of the obligate alkaliphile, of course, okay, their pH minimum is above or equal to 7.5. But if you consider the so-called alkaliphilic range that these organisms can tolerate, of course, okay, the facultative alkaliphile, in terms of its tolerance to higher pH, okay, it is or it does not or it cannot compete with that of the obligate alkaliphile. Alkaliphiles can also be classified into two physiological groups. Okay, so we have, as mentioned, alkali phials that require alkaline pH of 9 or more for growth, okay, as what we have as defined by Hirokoshi earlier, okay, as seen from the definition of Hirokoshi. And of course, you have the so-called haloalkaliphilic organisms. So in addition to an alkaline pH, there is also a need for high salinity, that is for these organisms to grow. And it can be up to around 33% weight per volume sodium chloride. Now, given our examples of alkaliphilic organisms, okay, so you have aerobic alkaliphiles such as Bacillus alkalophilus. Okay, so many species of Bacillus are also alkaliphilic. Then we also have anaerobic alkaliphiles like Clostridium paradoxum, okay, as example. And you have the haloalkaliphiles like Neutronobacterium gregorii. Now, methanogenic organisms also have representative alkaliphiles or represented like by Methanosalsus zillinae and Methanococcus vanniellae. Okay? And you also have the cyanobacteria. Okay? So many cyanobacteria are also alkaliphilic. And as mentioned by our speaker, Dr. Martinez, they were able to see cyanobacteria in, okay, high temperature environments, okay, part of the so-called microbial mats. Now, where can we find the alkaliphilic organisms? Okay, now they are found in alkaline soils, okay, alkaline lakes, now urea-containing sources, manure piles, ocean waters, alkaline springs, now even insect guts, they have alkaliphilic organisms like in the case of the termites. Now you also have alkaline saline environments, okay, so you have the soda lakes, okay, where a lot of organisms, that is diverse in terms of, okay, organisms capable of tolerating a, okay, high pH. Now, alkaliphilic organisms are also reported to be isolated from neutral environments, sometimes even from acidic soil samples. Now, as shown in the graph, okay, as presented in the work of Hirokoshi, okay, they were able to detect alkaliphilic organisms in acidic soil. And it was postulated that these organisms are capable of modifying the pH value, okay, for growth in a very small niche. Okay? Now, looking at neutral soils, it is said that alkaliphilic populations can reach until 10 to the 5. And of course, okay, as you grow higher, there's a corresponding increase in the number of alkaliphilic organisms which can be isolated and quantified. Now, it has also been reported that human excreta contains alkaliphilic organisms. In fact, Bacillus alkaloculus, okay, was isolated, or the first report of its isolation was from a human excreta in 1934. Okay, now other environments where we can find alkaliphilic organisms, of course, you have the man-made alkaline environments, okay? These are environments wherein, okay, a lot of alkali, okay, or basic materials are being released, okay, such as effluents from food processing. And it's been reported that in potato peeling processes, they employ a lot of alkali. Now, in textiles and tanneries, you have a lot of sodium hydroxide being utilized for scouring, okay, and in the process of washing, okay, the so-called materials, okay, a lot of waste, alkaline waste are being produced, thereby providing conditions for growth of these organisms. Now, paper and pulp production utilizes a lot of bleach, okay? And of course, okay, when these are released into the environment, okay, they also, okay, provide environments for growth of alkaliphilic organisms. Now, we discuss, okay, the so-called adaptation of alkaliphilic microorganisms. How do they survive in an environment with high pH? If you consider the effect of high pH, okay, to any living organism, okay, definitely, okay, the cells will be affected, their viability will be affected, cellular integrity will also be affected. So in the case of alkaliphilic organisms, okay, there are two challenges, okay, brought about by this alkaline environment. One is on pH homeostasis, and the other is on bioenergetics. Okay, high pH. Okay, What does high pH do to an organism? Okay, if you consider the effect of high pH, it can lead to biodegradation of degradation of biomolecules. There will be disruption of molecular bonds. Okay, so this will affect proteins, protein folding, and definitely their activity. Okay, you also have alkaline-mediated proteolysis, which is referred to as liquefactive denaturation. Now, as for the lipids which are present in the membrane, cell membrane of the organisms, okay, of course, you have the process of saponification. Okay, so definitely, okay, cellular materials are affected. And because of this, okay, there are adaptations, okay, observed in the alkaliphilic organisms in order to prevent degradation of biomolecules. Now, in the case of bioenergetics, okay, so how does an alkaline pH affect bioenergetics? Okay, if we can recall the proton motive force, which is discussed in our physiology, microbial physiology classes. Okay, so if you consider bioenergetics, of course, as we all know, how is proton motive force being produced? There is the continuous release of protons, okay, out of the cell. And in the process, you come up with more protons, okay, outside the membrane as compared to the cytoplasm. And because of this concentration gradient, okay, tendency is the protons will need to, okay, go back into the cell, passing through the ATPase in order to come up with ATP. Now, in the case of an alkaline environment, okay, please take note that that is not the case. Okay, so what is observed is that you have a more positive cytoplasm. So more protons are observed in the cytoplasm as compared, okay, to the outside part of the membrane. Now, what is the reason? Of course, the protons, okay, can easily be lost. Okay, it can easily be lost into the bulk medium or into the environment. Okay, you have the presence of a lot of hydroxide ions. Okay, so what happens is that there will be a corresponding drop in the protons, okay, outside the membrane, and this is a problem being faced for ATP synthesis by the alkaliphiles. So how do they go about, okay, in providing or in coming up with ATP, okay, the energy needed for metabolism? So there are, of course, again, adaptations observed in these organisms. And in fact, it is said that alkaliphilic organisms growing in alkaline or in high pH environments produce a lot of ATP, okay, needed in order to support metabolism. And growing in an alkaline environment requires a lot of energy. Now, of course, adding insult to the injury, okay, in such an environment, okay, will be, okay, the scarcity of nutrients like calcium, okay, so you have phosphorus, okay, iron, magnesium, okay, these are said to be, okay, limiting in alkaline environments. Okay, so these are the challenges, okay, that alkaliphilic organisms have to face in such an extreme environment. Okay, so what are the adaptations, okay, observed in these organisms? So what are the high pH adaptation mechanisms? Now, in the case of the membrane, it has been observed that they have high levels of cytochromes. Okay, so what is the importance of coming up with high levels of cytochromes? Okay, that is for more energy to be produced, efficient respiratory and cation proton antiporter systems. That is both for bioenergetics as well as ATP, that's bioenergetics as well as pH homeostasis. Now you have the presence of abundant unsaturated branched fatty acids, which, okay, as we have noted, okay, and as mentioned or discussed in our physiology class, this is usually observed in, okay, for these cyclophilic organisms, but for alkaliphilic organisms, they have also unsaturated branched fatty acids, monounsaturated fatty acids. Now, in addition, you have high concentrations of the lipids squalene and cardiolipin. Okay, and again, these are important in protecting the organism against the effect of hydroxide ions. Now, for the cell surface, it was observed that they have highly anionic cell surface. Again, this is a protection from negatively charged hydroxide ions, which can diffuse into the cell. Now, as for the cytoplasm, you have acid production, no ATPase activity, the efficient protein damage repair system, production of substances that tolerate alkalinization. And finally, in environments where there is less nutrients available, these organisms have to synthesize extracellular products to make it possible for them to get the limiting nutrients from the environment. So they have evolved to be operationally stable in high pH environment. And please take note that it is because of this characteristic of the extracellular products that humans are harnessing the alkaliphilic organisms to come up with products for various industrial processes. And it has been said that the conditions in industrial processes are said to be harsh, thereby affecting most of the enzymes. And with a stable enzyme under alkaliphilic conditions, they can remain functional. Now, looking more closely at pH homeostasis, it has been observed that for alkaliphilic organisms, and that is, of course, to maintain cellular integrity, the intracellular pH is lower or near neutral as compared to that what is present in the environment. So intracellular pH, and for some organisms like Bacillus pseudofirmus, the intracellular pH is more than 2 units lower than that of the extracellular pH. So there is a need to maintain intracellular pH at neutral to near neutral conditions to protect the biomolecules. And how does an alkaliphilic organism perform this homeostasis or pH homeostasis? That is, one, by acquiring protons. Two, reducing the leakage of the protons from the cytoplasm. Three, generate protons. And of course, deter hydroxide ingress or diffusion into the cell. Now, it is considered as the most important mechanism being utilized by alkaliphiles in order to survive in an alkaline environment. And that is a lot of monovalent cation or proton antiporters. Okay? So with the scarcity of protons, and of course, against the concentration gradient, so this mechanism is considered as the most important mechanism in taking in protons coming from the environment. Okay, so you have the monovalent cation proton antiporters, and these are said to be secondary active transporters, making use of the transmembrane electrical potential in order to take in protons and at the same time remove sodium from the cytoplasm. Okay, so this in a way prevents accumulation of cytoplasm, which is said to be toxic to the organism. Since there are a lot of mechanisms which allow the sodium ions to enter the cell, like the sodium gated transporters. Still, maintaining pH homeostasis, you look at the so-called ATPase, which are observed to be present in alkaliphiles. Now, first, in terms of ATPases present, there are a lot of ATPases or genes for synthesis of ATPases are upregulated in alkaliphilic organisms. And there are modifications which are found in the AT phases, okay, which in a way helps in pH homeostasis. Okay, so as shown in the figure, okay, so one characteristic of the AT phase found in alkaliphilic organisms is that such AT phases is incapable of an activity which is common with AT phases found in neutrophilic organisms. Okay, these AT phases are incapable of hydrolyzing ATP. Now, as we all know, okay, the AT phases can hydrolyze ATP, okay, and get the energy in order to pump proton, okay, out of the cell. So in the case of the alkaliphilic AT phases, modifications, okay, have occurred in the so-called amino acid residues found specifically in the alpha, okay, subunit of the alkaliphilic AT phase, thereby making it, okay, more effective in capturing protons and at the same time preventing it from extruding protons out of the cell. Now, another mechanism which is being utilized by alkaliphilic microorganisms is the so-called secondary cell wall polymer. So we now look at the cell surface, okay, or the cell wall of the organism, okay, the lipopolysaccharide or the outer membrane present in gram-negative organisms, okay. So what is so special with the cell wall, okay, of alkaliphilic microorganisms? Now, as observed in the gram-positive bacillus, alkaliphilic bacillus, okay, they have a lot of these secondary cell wall polymers. Okay, so these are negatively charged, okay, substances. One example is the tacuronopeptide unit, which forms the major polymeric cell wall component of alkaliphilic bacterial strains. These cell wall polymers contain a lot of, okay, negatively charged residues such as glutamic acid, glucuronic acid, aspartic acid, as well as phosphoric acids. Okay, so these negatively charged molecules are capable of trapping the protons which are being pumped out of the cell. Okay, so being negatively charged, they are capable of trapping the protons which are being pumped out of the cell. So in the process, it delays, okay, it delays the so-called loss of protons into the bulk medium or the environment, of course, because of this equilibrium. Okay, and in addition, okay, being negatively charged, they are also capable of repelling the hydroxide ions which are present in the environment. Now, in cases wherein hydroxide ions are successful in penetrating, okay, the cell wall of the organism, okay, the presence of the protons which are bound to this secondary cell wall polymers will neutralize the hydroxide ions. Okay, and it has been observed that as the organism is growing in an environment with increasing pH, there is a corresponding increase in the thickness of the cell wall. That is both for the peptidoglycan and the secondary cell wall polymers, thereby providing more negative charges, okay, giving protection to the organism. So that is for adaptation and for pH homeostasis. Now, how about bioenergetics? So in the case of ATP production. Now, as mentioned earlier, the cell membrane of alkaliphilic organisms possess, okay, the so-called squalene as well as cardiolipin. So looking at the structure of this cardiolipin as shown, okay, in the figure, okay, you have unsaturated fatty acids, and it is said that these unsaturated fatty acids also provide protection against the hydroxide ions. Okay, so these unsaturated fatty acids, in a way, can neutralize the hydroxide ions, which were successful in entering the cell or in the cytoplasm or the membrane. Okay, in the process, the double bond is converted to a single bond and water is released. But with the synthesis of the saturase enzymes, the double bond is again a form for it to provide another round of protection to the organism. Now, in addition, the top portion, the top portion of the cardiolipin, is negatively charged and it is capable of trapping protons. Okay, and similar with the secondary cell wall polymers, again, this is a way of neutralizing hydroxide ions entering the cell. Now, how is it important in bioenergetics? So looking at the figure at the left, you can see an illustration or representation of the respiratory complexes or the respiratory system observed in alkaliphilic bacillus. So for the alkaliphilic bacillus, in the presence of the cardiolipin, they are capable of causing the aggregation of the different complexes. It is like bringing all the complexes or the complexes 3 and 4 which are needed for ATP synthesis close to each other. So that is aggregation. And what does the what benefit will this give to the organism? So with this aggregation of the respiratory complexes, you will now have a short distance for the protons to travel. So instead of moving out of the cell, because of the short distance, then it is easier for the protons to reach the ATPases and for it to be brought back into the cell. And of course, with the negatively charged head of the cardiolipin, they can also serve as pool of protons. So the protons which are being pumped out by the complexes, are being trapped by the cardiolipin, and this in turn will serve as a pool of protons, which will then be provided to the ATPase. So that is how cardiolipins help in bioenergetics, aside from providing protection against hydroxide ions. Now, in addition, that is for bioenergetics, as mentioned earlier, there is a high concentration of cytochromes, specifically cytochrome C. So genes which are needed for synthesis of cytochromes are upregulated. And what is so special with the cytochromes produced by alkaliphilic organisms is that these cytochromes have been observed to have high electron retention potential or retention capacity. And with this high electron retention capacity, then it can also trap protons and provide a pool of protons for the respiratory system. Now, in addition, the so-called cytochromes have a lower midpoint redox potential than that of the neutrophiles. It is less than 100 millivolts. But the cytochrome oxidase, which is observed in both alkaliphilic as well as neutrophilic organisms, they have the same midpoint redox potential. So the higher the midpoint redox potential difference, the faster is, of course, the amount of ATP which is being produced, since the protons can easily be channeled into the ATPase. And it's been mentioned that because of this activity of the cytochromes, the formation of the microenvironment due to the action of the cardiolipin, alkaliphilic organisms produce ATP 7 times faster than that of neutrophilic organisms. And as mentioned earlier, these organisms, in order to grow in a highly alkaline environment, requires more energy. Okay? So 77 times faster ATP synthesis is observed with alkaliphilic microorganisms. And with this increase in ATP synthesis, definitely, okay, with oxygen serving as the terminal electron acceptor, okay, so there is a rapid utilization of oxygen, and it has been observed that indeed alkaliphilic organisms utilize more oxygen as compared to neutrophilic organisms. Now, please take note, okay, this is for the process of oxidative phosphorylation, which is observed in, okay, aerobic to facultatively anaerobic alkaliphilic microorganisms. For in the case of, okay, anaerobic alkaliphiles, they make use of other mechanisms such as a substrate level phosphorylation in producing ATP. Okay? So those are the adaptations observed, okay, in alkaliphilic microorganisms, that is for both pH homeostasis and bioenergetics. Now, moving on. Okay, now, what are the so-called biotechnological applications of alkaliphilic organisms such that a lot of scientists and researchers or microbiologists are really, okay, working on alkaliphiles? Okay? Now, they have a lot of biotechnological applications. Okay? So they can be used for bioremediation, okay, of high pH environments, okay? They are also being utilized for bioconstruction because of the formation of exopolysaccharides, okay? Formation of calcites. These organisms are capable of producing substances which in a way can be used for construction. In fact, there are studies, okay, wherein alkaliphiles are being, okay, introduced into materials which are being used for construction. That is because of the exopolysaccharides that they produce, because of the precipitation of minerals that they do, it is capable of binding materials, okay, which are being used for construction. Now, they are also being used for pharmaceuticals. They are capable of forming organic acids. Okay, so there are really many uses of alkaliphiles. But the main use of the so-called organisms is on enzyme production. Okay? Now, enzymes which are being used for detergents, you have proteases, lipases, as well as cellulases being added into detergents. And as we all know, with detergents, they actually make use of laundry detergents, okay, and it is being utilized in washing, there is a corresponding, okay, increase in pH, and with the proteases or the enzymes coming from alkaliphiles, they are more stable. Okay, now synthesis, lipases and esterases are also being used, and in fact, okay, a lipase from an alkaliphilic organism is being used in order to form, okay, ethyl valerate, which is a flavoring agent. Okay. Now, they are also being used in paper and pulp production. A lot of enzymes are being utilized, not only silanases. You have malonases, okay, pectinases coming from, okay, alkaliphilic organisms. And the same is true with textile, especially in scouring. So, some countries are now using alkaliphiles for bioscouring, that is removing pectin fibers from cottons. Okay, and the same is true for leather. You have a lot of lipases, proteases, and even in oil recovery, okay, malonases from alkaliphilic organisms are also being utilized. Okay, so that is, okay, giving you information about alkaliphilic organisms, okay, and their adaptation. Now, a little break, okay? So another question that I want to ask, especially the students, unfortunately, I have no way of seeing the answers of our students. Okay, so one point to ponder, okay? Now, how do detergents enhance the brightness of cotton garment to its new condition? I think we have seen this in a lot of commercials on detergents, and it is said that detergents are capable of bringing back the color of garments. Okay, so what do you think is the reason? Okay, why? Okay, brightness of cotton garment is enhanced to give it its new condition. Okay, so please think about it. Okay, so how do these detergents really enhance the color of garments? Okay, now the answer is, of course, due to the cellulases, alkaline cellulases, which are added or incorporated or added into laundry detergents. Okay, if you have your cotton garment, so you have your clothes with the continuous washing, wearing, washing, what happens is that short cellulose fibers are released. Kumbaga, parang nagkakaroon siya ng himulmol. I'm not mistaken, di ba? Himulmol. Okay, so we have short fibers being produced. And these short fibers, so in a way, this makes the color of the garment dull. And in addition, it is also capable of trapping dirt. Okay, and this, again, causes the so-called dullness of the cotton garments. Now, with the cellulases added into detergents, so if you see, this is a secret, of such detergents, is that the cellulases are capable of removing those small fibers and as well as the dirt, and thereby giving you the bright or the so-called enhanced brightness of your garment, giving it's like a new garment. So that is the secret, the cellulases which are being added into the detergents. Okay, now we move on, of course, to the study which was conducted on one naturally occurring alkaline environment in the country, and that is the Manliluwag alkaline. Now, in some, they are referring to it as Manliluwag hyperalkaline spring, which is found in Pangasinan. So, what we did is to do molecular as well as culture-based characterization of the bacterial community found in the said hyperalkaline spring. So you have molecular characterization of the bacterial community. And at the same time, of course, with the so-called biotechnological applications, potential of these organisms, we also did isolation and screening of alkaliphilic bacteria producing industrially important enzymes. Okay. Now, short description of the site. Okay. The hyperalkaline spring is found in the Manliluwag Spring National Park. It is located in Mangatarem, Pangasinan, with coordinates as shown. Okay. Now, it is one of the 34 protected areas in the country. Now, the Manliluwag Spring National Park is a set of two opulistic hot springs, which is near the 923-foot-tall extinct volcano Mount Malabobo. Now, please take note that in addition to Manliluwag hot springs, there are still other alkaline springs which are observed in the area. Okay. Now, for the alkaline spring, in terms of its pH, the water pH ranges from 10 to 11.5. But the temperature is within the mesophilic range, that is 33 to 36 degrees Celsius. Okay, now this alkaline spring, is converted in this spring, is becoming alkaline because of the process of serpentinization, which is simply the low temperature weathering of the calcium and magnesium containing silicate materials found in the area. Okay. So you have olivine as well as pyroxene. Okay, so these are calcium and magnesium containing silicate materials. Now in the presence of water together with carbon dioxide, what happened is that this undergoes degradation in order to release the calcium, the iron, the silicic acid as well as the magnesium. Okay. Now, the silicic acid as well as the magnesium in turn, okay, forms the serpentine mineral. Okay, so that's why it's being referred to as serpentinization due to the formation of this serpentine. Now, in addition, you have iron being released, okay, hydroxide being released. So you have the formation of ferrous hydroxide, okay, ferric oxides, okay. So the condition is also said to be reducing because of the presence of ferrous ions as well as the presence of hydrogen. Now you also have an excess of calcium, okay, and hydroxide. Okay, so what happens is you have the formation of calcium carbonate and also the formation of calcium hydroxide. Now the calcium hydroxide is said to be in equilibrium, that is the insoluble calcium hydroxide is said to be in equilibrium with the calcium ions and the hydroxide ions which are present in the water. So this is the reason why okay, alkalinity is observed in the so-called spring. Okay, now the sites where samples were collected, so you have three different locations. Okay, of course we have A, that is considered the main pool or the main source. And please take note that this is the source which provide water to several swimming pools which are found in the area. Okay, so it is actually a resort, okay, being frequented by a lot of people. Now you also have several springs which are found, okay, with near, okay, the main pool. Now a brief, okay, or a general diagram of the procedure. Of course, both water and sediment samples were collected. Okay, and in order to do this community, bacterial community characterization, okay, we did whole genome shotgun sequencing after DNA extraction. Now, for the second objective, which is isolation and characterization, as well as screening for activity, okay, enrichment procedure was done, okay, followed by the usual, okay, microbiological methods until okay, assays have been conducted to score for enzymes as well as antimicrobial substances. Then finally, those potential or organisms which are said to be potential sources of such important bioactive compounds, they are then characterized and identified. Now, for molecular characterization of the bacterial community, in the case of the bacterial phyla, it was observed that there are around 40 bacterial phyla as well as 9 archaea found in the area. And the 10 most abundant bacterial phyla are listed as follows. Of course, the highest is proteobacteria, followed by chloroflexi, until the aromatimonodetes. Now, as for the bacterial classes, in the case of the bacterial classes, we were able to observe around 72 okay, bacterial classes. And as discussed earlier okay, by the first speaker, in an environment which is said to be alkaline, there are a lot of beta proteobacteria observed to be present. So you have the beta proteobacteria followed by the alpha, gamma, and the rest of organisms. So again, there were 72 bacterial classes observed in the said alkaline spring. Now, as for the genera of bacteria, there were 1,705 bacterial genera observed. Okay, and the highest or the most abundant were Meiothermus, Thiobacillus, Lentimicrobium, Eleuria. Okay, so similar with what has been observed. Okay, in other environments, okay, which are said to be alkaliphilic, and as discussed again by the earlier speaker, they were able to detect okay, some of these organisms in alkaline hot springs. Now, for the bacterial species detected, okay, total bacterial species detected were around 11,998 bacterial species. And given are the 10 most abundant bacterial species. You have the chloroflexi, okay, again, the lentimicrobium, okay, and the rest of the species. So again, 11,998 species of bacteria were detected in the alkaline spring. Now moving on to the culture-dependent methods and of course screening for enzymatic activity, okay? From the said area wherein several samplings were conducted, okay, a total of 826 bacteria were isolated. Okay, partial characterization, that is in terms of gram reaction, okay, you have around 771 gram positive bacteria and 55 gram negative bacteria. This is similar with what has been observed in other studies dealing with alkaline environments, that there are more gram-positive bacteria as compared to the gram-negative ones. Now, screening for proteolytic activity, okay, for protease activity, we were able to, that is putative, okay, producers of protease, you have 428. Now, in the case of the cyclodextrin glycosyl transferase, or the CGTase activity, which is very important not only in the pharmaceutical but the food industry, we were able to get 4, okay, bacteria producing such an enzyme. Now for asparaginase activity, now please take note that asparaginase is very important, especially in the pharmaceutical industry, because it is being used as an anti-cancer agent, that is for anti-cancer therapy, okay? I think specifically for a certain type of leukemia. Okay, so we were able to get, okay, that is putative, 97 isolates. And as for antimicrobial assay, since many antimicrobial substances has been reported being produced by the alkaliphilic bacteria, and using Staphylococcus aureus, E. coli, as well as Pseudomonas aeruginosa as the test organisms, we were able to get 16 isolates with activity against Staphylococcus aureus, 4 isolates with activity against Escherichia coli, and unfortunately, none was active against the third test organism. Now, for the so-called proteolytic activity or protease activity, we made use of the skim milk assay, that is for the presumptive testing for protease activity, and of course, following, okay, the values which were reported by Price et al., that is for the ZZ value, we were able to classify the activities of these protease producers as either weak, poor, moderate, or high. And given, okay, are the top protease producers after several rounds of assay. Okay, we have isolates, okay, which are in a way classified as high protease producers. Now shown on the figures are, okay, the so-called zones of clearing observed, okay, when the organisms are inoculated on skim milk agar. The next enzyme is the cyclodextrin glucosyl transferase activity. And to perform this assay, of course, presumptive, okay, we made use of the phenolphthalein assay. Now, first drawing the organism on the medium, okay, of course, with phenolphthalein as the indicator, so that is the qualitative phenolphthalein assay, and again, looking at the CC values, we were able to get several isolates positive for, okay, such an enzyme activity. Now, for the quantitative assay, okay, for CGTase activity, again, okay, the same indicator was used, the same assay was used, but this time making use of a liquid medium. Now, for the top 10, okay, highest producer of the CGTase enzyme, okay, so they are listed in the given table, and their activities were compared with that of Penibacillus, which is the reference strain. And it was observed that some of these organisms are producing, okay, CGTase at concentrations which is much higher than what is being produced by Penibacillus. Now, moving on to another enzyme, we also tried to screen for asparaginase activity, okay, which has been reported to important in anti-cancer therapy. Okay, So using Hirokoshi medium, of course, with L-asparagine and an indicator from Thymoblue, we were able to detect some organisms which are capable of producing, okay, the asparaginase enzyme, and that is based on, okay, the color production, okay, that is upon degradation of asparagine leading to the formation of ammonia, giving rise to the blue-colored reaction. Now, we also did quantitative assay, that is by Nestlerization, and looking at the ammonia concentration being produced, and we were able to detect 5 organisms producing, okay, certain amount of, okay, the so-called asparaginase enzyme. And finally, for the antimicrobial assay, okay, we made use of the usual antimicrobial assay, and as mentioned, 3 test organisms, Staphylococcus, E. coli, and Pseudomonas, and we were able to get activities against Staph aureus and E. coli. Okay, now, performing several rounds of this antimicrobial assay, we were able to come up with the 5 highest, okay, or organisms producing, okay, in a way, moderate activity against the test organisms. Okay, so we have a total of 4 of such organisms. So all those organisms, the top producers, okay, observed in the different assays, they were then characterized and identified. Now, molecular characterization conducted on these organisms, we were able to get the identity of such organisms. Okay. Now, many of the isolates, we were able to get 99% similarity, but in some, okay, there were values, similarity values, which are less than that of 97%. Now, we also did this, we also constructed the phylogenetic tree, and in a way, this will help us, okay, have an idea as to the identity of those organisms having low or percent similarity, which is less than that of 97%. And this is true for, this is for the 17, okay, isolates that we have obtained having this potential biotechnological application. Okay, so with that, okay, so we have discussed about, so in summary, we have discussed about alkaliphilic organisms. So you were informed about the characteristics of the alkaliphilic organisms, their adaptation, and at the same time, I've shown you the results of our studies, okay, which is dealing with an organism found in a hyperalkaline spring, okay, in Pangasinan. Okay, so of course, we acknowledge, okay, the funding which was provided to us by EIDR, and also with the help of the Fisher, that is for monitoring, and the members of the research team. As mentioned, it is divided into 2 projects. So it's actually the program which is divided into 2 projects. So we have project 1, which was headed by Dr. Jenaline Diaz, and of course with Professor April Manalang and Ms. Mari Carbordeos. Now for the project 2, where I am a part of the second project, it was headed by our project leader, Dr. Nasita Lantican, okay, with Professor Andrew Montesilio, okay, Rose Ann Franco, Ms. Marian Bertuso, and Ms. Yula Bosito. And with that, thank you very much for listening to my friend, for staying with me and listening to the said presentation. Okay, so thank you very much.